Hey, what's up, everybody? Thanks for tuning in to Wednesday Night Live from wherever you are. Tonight, we are finishing up this mini-series we've been on about the life and writings of the prophet Jeremiah. And I want to close it by talking about maybe the most well-known verse in the entire book, at least for modern American Christians, Jeremiah 29:11. "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future." It's an amazing promise that we totally misunderstand. We hear it quoted out of context all the time, and we figure it means that God's just gonna bless our socks off and give us whatever blessings we long for in life if we just follow him. And then things like 2020 happen. All of it, like all of the mind-bending horribleness of it, and we go, wait up, God isn't keeping his promise. This doesn't feel like prospering at all. It feels like harm. God lied. But here's the deal. He didn't lie. He was actually saying something totally different than we think he was saying in Jeremiah 29. See, the Israelites had rebelled against God, and so he allowed them to be conquered. The Babylonians under King Nebuchadnezzar demolished the city of Jerusalem and carried all the people off into exile. And the people cried out to God. They begged to go home. They prayed for forgiveness for all their sins and asked God to please make a way for them to return to their homeland. And in Jeremiah 29, God says, No, you're not going home. You're going to live and die here in this place that isn't where you want to be. In the middle of this hostile culture and fragmented society, this is where you are for the next 70 years, for the rest of your lives. But guess what? I got a purpose for you right here. This is what he says. Starting verse 4, to his people living in a land of brokenness and darkness where they don't want to be. It says, this is what the Lord God Almighty, the God of Israel, says to all those I carried into exile from Jerusalem to Babylon. Build houses and settle down. Plant gardens and eat what they produce. Marry and have sons and daughters. Find wives for your sons. Give your daughters in marriage so that they too may have sons and daughters. Increase in number. Do not decrease. Also, seek the peace and prosperity of the city to which I have carried you into exile. Pray to the Lord for it, because if it prospers, you too will prosper. Yes, this is what the Lord Almighty, the God of Israel, says. Do not let the prophets and diviners among you deceive you. Do not listen to the dreams you encourage them to have. They're prophesying lies to you in my name. I have not sent them, declares the Lord. These are all the people who are telling them, you're going to go home soon, right? God says, no, don't listen to them. They're lying. This is what the Lord says. When 70 years are completed for Babylon, I will come to you and fulfill my good promise to bring you back to Jerusalem. For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you a hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart. I love this chapter of the Bible, you guys. I think it's so important for us in the middle of this crazy season of life because it answers this question all of us are asking. How do we live in the middle of this fragmented society? How do we respond to the hostile culture that surrounds us? And the natural answer to that, at least if you're anything like me, is to despair, to just throw our hands up and feel crushed by it all and just wallow in hopelessness. It's easy for worry and surrender and withdrawal to dominate our thinking to the point we just lose hope. Or we just bail on our culture. We decide the world is too far gone. Everybody's too messed up to be worth our time. They're evil and they're our enemies. But check out what God says in Jeremiah 29. He says there are basically two approaches to dealing with a broken world around us that don't work, that aren't his approach. And one that does work, one that is the approach to the culture that God created us for. And the first bad way is assimilation. This is what God's talking about when he says, increase in number, don't decrease. See, the Babylonians were actually a genius culture. There was a reason they conquered the world. They were really, really good at keeping people in line and dealing with the descent of all these unruly nations they'd conquered. What they figured out was something that modern social scientists have come to also discover. Like now we know they were right about this. The best way to oppress people is assimilation. You can expel them, you can kick them out of their land, but they're just going to come back madder. You can lord it over them, you can enslave them, But then they're going to rebel at some point. The best way to oppress them, the best way to take from them the lives they want, the lives they were made for, the lives they were living, is to invite them into your life. To educate them, give them jobs, and tempt them to just join in. Tempt them to participate and adopt your culture intellectually, socially, and spiritually. If you can just assimilate people within a few generations, those people have been wiped out completely. They're gone. They're just more of you, and there's no distinction anymore. And that's exactly what the Babylonians did with all the people they conquered. They gave them enough of a taste of wealth and opulence that they just adopted and adapted Babylonian culture. They assimilated. But God says, no. I didn't make you to live like the world. Don't chase after the false gods of the Babylonian culture. If your life doesn't look different than the life of the average person in your city who doesn't believe in me at all, like noticeably different, you are doing it wrong. Don't assimilate. And the second wrong way to do it is tribalism. See, the Babylonians had this agenda of assimilation, but the Jewish prophets and religious leaders had an agenda too, separation. And in verse 7, God says, don't listen to those guys anymore. Forget these so-called prophets and diviners who keep telling you just stay. God's going to let us go home really quickly if we just cut ourselves off completely from the Babylonian people. If we write them off and hold a hand up to them. Because those guys, even in the chapter right before this, they were telling the people, don't move into the city. Do not interact with the Babylonian people beyond exploiting them for the gain of our little tribe. Like, we'll live here on the outskirts of the city together, and we'll avoid them, and God will let us go home, and forget all those evil people who are our enemies. We'll just try and use them. Like, assimilation asks this question, how can I use the city that I've come to love for my own personal gain? And tribalism asks, how can I use this city that I secretly hate to gain power for myself and my group? But God says, I got a totally different way. And understand, this way God proposes is shocking. It's totally nuts for the Israelites to hear, and it's not what they were expecting at all. They were maybe tempted to move toward assimilation. Most of them figured that God was going to take them out of there, and they should just go with tribalism, like avoid them completely because they're bad. Or that maybe God was going to go with judgment, like fire and brimstone. Like, yeah, we got judged for rebelling, but look how bad Babylon is. God's going to burn their city and just give us everything after he wipes them out. But God throws this whole different plan into motion. He tells them, move in, settle down, raise a family, plant a garden, build a life. Right there, like right here, right where you are. Right among the lost and the confused and the broken, in proximity to those living in darkness and hopelessness. And not just that, God goes a step further. Not only does he say to like go live in the city and make a life among its wicked pagan people, he says, pray for the city, pray for those people, seek peace and prosperity for this place and this community where I've got you right now. And this is even crazier. I mean, it's one thing for them to live there, but the people hear this and they're thinking, pray? For Babylon? It's a wicked city. Like, it's conquered the world. Its leaders' hands are dripping with blood. This place is filled with idiots and pagans and awful people who despise God. And we're supposed to pray for them? God just gives them this wonderfully counterintuitive, countercultural instruction. Don't just let your life be about your life. See the people around you through my eyes. Live your life in a way that seeks out and contributes to human flourishing right where you are. Be people who seek and bring peace to everybody around you. You guys, this word from Jeremiah 29 is a word for us in 2020. Our world is dying for people who bring hope and peace right now. Everybody around us is hurting and lost and running out of hope, and they're desperate to breathe the oxygen of God's love, desperate to find the hope that only comes through him. And we are not here now by accident. We are right here, right now, right where we are, whether we want to be or not, in order to bring that kind of hope to our hurting world. Like, our mission at Revision Church is to help people meet Jesus and follow him fully. It isn't just to build a better church for ourselves. Like, this whole thing is about building a better city, because that's what the gospel does. Like, when we know the truth about who God is and what God did for us and how he invites us and how he gave everything, died and rose again so we could be forgiven and set free, it changes the world. Like, it increases the common good. It inspires service and self-sacrifice. It ushers in mercy and justice where they're lacking. It makes workplaces more humane. It makes art more hopeful. It makes racial and cross-cultural relations healthier. The good news of Jesus changes lives. And lives changed to look like Jesus become catalytic in a world that's desperate for catalysts that can bring change and bring hope. You guys, Jesus changes everything. He inspires us to go out and be a part and to give ourselves and our lives for a city full of people that aren't like us and sometimes don't like us. But check it out. When Jesus died for me, I wasn't anything like him and I didn't like him. I was a rebel in my sin, but he gave his life for me. And because of that, I can go do the same for the people around me, even in the middle of difficulty, even in the middle of a divisive season. I can catch a kingdom vision of a life lived for a greater purpose than me and mine in this lifetime. And I can give myself for the sake of those who aren't like me or don't like me because Jesus changes everything. And that's the story of the world for the last 2,000 years. And it's Des Moines' story for as long as Revision Church is breathing. Like, I want us to look in the mirror from this day forward and see something new. I want us to look at ourselves and see the catalytic potential God has given us. Like, every place you go, every person you meet, the way you communicate, you live, you work, and you play, you're a culture maker. You are a gospel carrier. You're a catalyst for bringing hope and flourishing that our world needs desperately right now. And I think if we can catch a vision for that, for laying down our lives for the sake of our city, allowing God to shape the life of Jesus in us in such a way that we can deliver this incredible gospel message of hope and mercy and love to the people around us who feel like they are dying in 2020, we just might be able to change the flavor of Des Moines. And we might even be able to change the world.